In August 2024, an ATS-72 crashed near Sao Paulo in Brazil. When it became known that the aircraft had been dispatched into an area with forecasted severe icing conditions, the blame game began.
ATR-72 is a very dangerous airplane.
It's a flying Russian roulette.
That wing is designed for disaster.
ATR is a piece of crap.
Hello aviators, how are you today? My name is Magnar Nordahl, I'm an ATR captain and instructor. And I am recording from Wailoa Loa open window studio. The birds are singing and there are some thunderstorms in nearby. Through the history of aviation, many remarkable airplanes have emerged, both military and civilian. Some designs are nearly flawless from the start, while others face early challenges before evolving into legendary machines. Take, for instance, the de Havilland Comet, the world's first commercial jetliner. Initially celebrated as a technological marvel, it revolutionized air travel with its pressurized cabin and unmatched speed, offering passengers a new level of comfort. However, tragedy struck shortly after its introduction. Three comets broke apart in flight, claiming 99 lives. Investigations revealed the cause to be structural failure linked to metal fatigue in the airframe, a consequence of repeated pressurization cycles of the cabin. This was not fully understood at that time. Further investigation revealed critical design flaws, such as improper riveting and dangerous stress concentrations around square cutouts for the ADF antennas. These findings prompted a comprehensive redesign, transforming the Comet into a reliable aircraft that served British Airlines and the Royal Air Force for many, many years. Five decades ago marked the dawn of the widebody era. The Boeing 747, known as the Queen of the Skies, entered service in 1970, followed by the Douglas DC-10 in 1971 and the Lockheed L-1011 TriStar in 1972. To maximize cargo hold capacity, this aircraft featured outward opening cargo doors, a design choice that later proved problematic, especially for the DC-10. In June 1972, an American Airlines DC-10 experienced a cargo door failure mid-flight, causing rapid decompression. This resulted in collapse of the cabin floor and its severed cables controlling the rudder and engine number 2. Despite the severity of the incident, all 67 occupants survived. Following the incident, Douglas modified the door latching system, but the upgrades were not universally adopted by all airlines. One such airline was Turkish Airlines. In March 1974, a DC-10 operated by the carrier experienced a similar cargo door failure. This time, the consequences were far graver. The damage led to a complete loss of rudder and elevator control, causing the aircraft to crash and killing all 346 on board. This tragedy forced a comprehensive redesign of the latching system, ensuring that similar incidents will not occur again. But the story didn't end here. In February 1989, a United Airlines Boeing 747 suffered a cargo door failure mid-flight, causing extensive damage to the fuselage, one wing, and two engines. Out of 355 people on board, 9 died and 38 were injured. Boeing subsequently redesigned the cargo door latching system. Yet, the 747 was found to have another flaw. In December 1991, a China Airlines cargo, Boeing 747, suffered a catastrophic failure when the pylon attaching engine number 3 to the wing failed. The engine separated, striking engine number 4, which also detached. The crew lost control of the aircraft, resulting in a crash that claimed the lives of all 5 on board. Tragically, a similar event happened 10 months later. This time, an El Al cargo flight experienced the same failure. Engine number 3 broke off, hitting engine number 4 and damaged the wing. The aircraft crashed into a residential building, killing all 4 crew members and 43 people on the ground. In response to these disasters, the engine pylon design was completely overhauled, ensuring the Boeing 747 will continue its service with enhanced safety and reliability. But we are not finished with Boeing yet. This time it's a 737. In 1991 and 1994, two catastrophic incidents occurred when pilots lost control of the aircraft due to sudden and unexpected rudder deflections. These accidents resulted in the loss of 157 lives. Additionally, similar rudder issues caused temporary loss of control in at least 5 of the 737 flights, before the underlying problem was identified. The NTSB concluded that the accident stemmed from a design flaw in the rudder servo valve. After the valve was redesigned, the issue was permanently resolved. As I record this video, it's December 2024, and it's exactly 25 years ago since I started my training on the ATR. First the 42, later the 72. During my initial training, there was a significant emphasis on severe icing conditions. We studied the tragic accident with American Eagle Flight 4184, which occurred 5 years earlier my training, in October 1994, claiming the lives of 68 passengers and crew. In the simulator, we were trained to recognize the signs of severe icing and execute escape maneuvers. Much has been said about this incident, and I have made a video about it. You will find a link in the description below. The NTSB determined that the probable cause was loss of control resulting from a sudden and unexpected aileron hinge moment reversal. This occurred after ice had built up beyond the de-icing boots on the wings, forming a ridge. Before this accident, there had been incidents where ATR-42s experienced similar aileron hinge moment issues. But in those cases, the crews managed to recover. To address the issues with the ATR, they installed the vortex generators ahead of the ailerons. And following the 1994 accident, all ATRs were retrofitted with extended de-icing boots that covered more of the wing's upper surface. Additionally, ATR introduced the aircraft performance monitoring, APM. This system alerts the flight crews when ice accumulation increases aerodynamic drag, resulting in loss of performance. Since 1994, all ice-related incidents and accidents with ATR aircraft happen because the crew either didn't respect minimum operational speeds in icing conditions, they didn't react to APM warnings, or they executed stall recovery in the wrong way. I have created a video analyzing 3 such incidents where the crew managed to recover. In October 1963, a prototype BAC-111 crashed during a stall test. The aircraft entered a deep stall, and due to the T-tail, the wake from the wings blocked the airflow to the horizontal stabilizer, resulting in loss of elevator control. The solution to this issue was installation of a stick pusher, which forces the control column forward before the stall fully develops. The stick pusher is activated after the normal stall warning, which typically triggers a stick shaker and an alarm in the cockpit when a certain angle of attack is reached. And if the angle of attack continues to increase, the stick pusher is activated. Most aircraft with T-tail designs are equipped with stick pusher. However, Boeing 727 and McDonnell Douglas MD-80 were initially designed without this feature. Both companies were reluctant to introduce automation that could potentially interfere with the pilot's control of the aircraft. However, some European authorities mandated installation of stick pressure before they could certify these aircraft. In addition to lacking stick pressure, MD-80s have another peculiar feature. When the stall warning is triggered, the autopilot does not automatically disconnect. This was a critical factor in the August 2005 accident involving West Caribbean Flight 70, which resulted in the tragic loss of 160 lives. In October 2018, a Boeing 737 MAX operated by Lion Air crashed shortly after takeoff, killing all 189 people on board. The aircraft was equipped with the Maneuvering Characteristics Augmentation System, MCAS, which was designed to automatically trim the stabilizer nose down if the angle of attack exceeded a certain threshold, this to prevent a stall. However, Boeing failed to provide operators with critical information about the MCAS system and associated procedures. The day before the accident, a miscalibrated angle of attack sensor had been installed on the left side of the aircraft. It was reading 20 degrees higher angle of attack than the actual angle of attack. The other angle of attack sensor functioned properly, but there was no alert in the cockpit to indicate a discrepancy between the two sensors. Once airborne, the stick shaker on the captain's side activated. When the flaps was retracted, the MCAS, receiving a high angle of attack signal from the faulty sensor, began trimming the stabilizer nose down. This led to loss of control of the aircraft. Then, just 5 months later, disaster struck again. A Boeing 737 MAX operated by Ethiopian Airlines crashed after takeoff, killing all 157 people on board. This time, the left angle of attack sensor failed just 10 seconds after rotation, triggering both the stall and overspeed warnings. Additionally, the faulty angle of attack sensor caused the autothrottle to fail in reducing takeoff thrust to climb thrust. When the flaps was retracted, the MCAS activated two times, trimming the nose down. The pilots moved the stabilizer trim cutout switches to the cutout position, but by that time, they were struggling to prevent the aircraft from diving down. The first officer attempted to manually trim the nose up, but due to the high speed, aerodynamic forces on the stabilizer prevented the trim from moving. In this video, Mentor Pilot demonstrates how difficult it is to operate the stabilizer trim when it is severely out of trim. Thank you, Petter, for letting me use this clip. And you will find a link to the full video below. Had the manual trim been easier to operate, the Ethiopian Airlines crew might have been able to regain control and land safely. In a desperate attempt to reduce the force on the control column, they re-engaged the stabilizer trim and tried to trim the nose up. But it didn't work, because the MCAS activated again and sealed the fate of the aircraft. So there you have it. Cargo doors have been redesigned, engine pylons improved, rudder actuators upgraded, de-icing boots modified, and the MCAS is now behaving properly. But remember one thing, regardless of the aircraft you are flying, it is so important to remember the limitations of the aircraft and all the quirks and special features that follows that specific aircraft. You fully have to understand how your aircraft is operating. If you like the content I am making, please consider becoming a member. Your support is very important for me. Thank you to all of you already supporting me. And one of the perks I give to the members is that you will have access to the video 2 days before everybody else. And during those 2 days, there are no advertisements. Okay, that's all for this time. Thank you for watching. Have a wonderful day and happy landing.